playing white from the United States, Larry Christensen, playing black from the United Kingdom, Nigel Short. Now last year, of course, Nigel Short won this tournament. He had a splendid time. He won his group, which included Gligorik, Byrne and Vlastimil Hort, then went on to win the final. He hasn't been doing so well in chess anywhere this last year, and he isn't doing terribly well in this tournament either. Larry Christensen, on the other hand, as you can see from the board, is doing extremely well. He needs only a draw today to make absolutely certain of a playoff, and a win today would put him into the final, and he really must rather fancy his chances with Short being in the form that he is. Bill Hartson, as usual. Bill, let's join the game straight away. See how they get down to it with Christensen playing white against a really rather out-of-form Short.
Well, even an out-of-form Nigel Short is a pretty fine player. Christensen opening with the queen's pawn. And Nigel replying with one of his favourite openings, the queen's Indian defence, which we reach with black's third move. B6, preparing to put his bishop on this long white diagonal. That's a funny little pawn move, just preventing black's other bishop from coming out to B4. It's a very sharp line, black striking back immediately in the centre. White pushing his d-pawn. Now it's a very odd development, bishop attacking the c-pawn. Very sharp opening already. Queen defends the pawn. Exchange of pawns in the centre. Now black's trying to punish white for all his pawn moves by playing two bishop moves, now attacking this pawn. Christensen defending it. And Nigel's breaking all the rules in the opening, but this move wins a pawn. He's attacking the e-pawn twice, and also this d5 pawn, which is now taken by the knight because the e-pawn is pinned by the queen to the king. But black's considerably gummed up his developments to win this pawn, so a rather risky pawn-grabbing attempt. White's castled, now the knight has to retreat. Goes back to c7, so after the opening, black has won a pawn. White sacrificed it, but he still has to complete his development.
Is there any sort of rule or thumb as to whether or not to sacrifice pawns in the opening like that?
No, none at all. It's interesting how much more sophisticated pawn sacrifices are nowadays than the old gambit openings. And this one is a very complex opening sequence that we've just seen, with black moving a bishop twice, white advancing in the centre, and black playing a three-move combination to win a pawn. It's quite different from the old king's gambits. The Philidor rule was that a pawn is worth three moves in development.
And in fact, the game has been going on until now. We've reached this position after white's 21st move, Bill.
And as you can see, black's still got his extra pawn, but it's not as good as it was. It's now part of a doubled pawn. His pawn's on d4, d6. White knight quite dominating on d5, but liable to be exchanged by the bishop. And Christensen trying to build up an attack on the king's side with his queen.
And let's join the game with Short black to play.
I'd like to take on d5 and play bishop f6. And then rook c6. Maybe I could save a tempo by playing bishop f6 immediately. And then on, say, rook c4, then I take on d5. Well, I'm going to have to take on d5 anyway sometime. But first of all, I'll play bishop f6.
Well, that's nice. Doesn't take on d5, it leads to a pretty drawish position. I can't lose that, I don't think. But now he gives me the chance to play the rather obvious rook c6. If he takes my rook, I got a terrible passed pawn and incredibly strong knight on d5. That is just killing. Now, rook c6 attacks his d-pawn, puts pressure on the c-file. I could play it safe and play queen d7. I want to win this game. Rook c6.
Oh, I'd forgotten about that one. I can't really take on c6 now. The c-pawn would be too strong. That's a bit of a blow. I can't really move anything now. Rook c6 seems to almost completely paralyze me. Still, what's he threatening? Queen d7 looks like a strong threat. What do I do? I think I should protect my bishop on f6, play king g7.
No, he sees my threat, but he's not doing much in the position. I might as well continue my plan and strengthen my pressure on the c-file. Rook fc1.
No, there really isn't much to do in this position. I'd like to drive his queen away from its present diagonal. I don't know what to do. Let's just attack his queen, play h5.
Well, now, I'd like to play queen g3 and attack d6. Yeah, queen g3 has a lot to say for it. Queen h3 also keeps looking down at that, on that long diagonal. I want to cover that d7 square in particular, not let his queen come out. He's also weakened his g-pawn, his king position, somewhat. I think I might be able to take advantage of that later. Yeah. He's got to win this game. I don't see how the hell he's going to do it now. Unless I make some sort of horrible blunder. That won't happen. Queen h3, that's the move.
That's interesting. I can almost win his queen here with bishop c8. But the problem is just queen g3 attacks my d-pawn. Oh, well. What should I do? Like to hit his e-pawn there. Rook e8. I haven't really got that many legal moves in this position. It's rook e8.
I think I'd increase the pressure on the king side and expand a bit with f4. Also, my king's now safe from back rank mate. And I can perhaps start an e5. Take advantage of the loose position of his bishop on f6. And what's he going to do? He can't take the rook. That's out of the question. A6? It looks too loosening. But perhaps. E5 is... it'll be too strong. What's he going to do? Well, this tournament's sewed up. F4.
This is definitely looking grim. He's just going to go e5 now, which seems to do me over quite quickly. Well, play for swindles. On e5, I'm going to have to answer it by playing bishop takes e5, followed by rook takes e5. But I'd like to have another threat in the position. Maybe a6... is a good move, but I've not much choice. I've got to get some activity in this position. A6 threatens just to take on b5 and hit his a3 pawn. Yes, a6.
Well, it puts a little bit of a thorn in my path. I really didn't expect that. Now, what about e5? Didn't he consider that? Maybe he overlooked it. But e5, what's his plan? What's his idea? All looks good to me. E5, though, just seems too much. His king position's weak, too. Maybe I can mate him, get this over with quick. Yeah, e5 just looks too much. E5, let's roll him up.
Well, I was half looking forward to that. I haven't got much choice here. I must give up my piece. It's the only chance for some active play. Bishop takes e5.
I kind of underestimated that. I really didn't look at it that much. For some bizarre reason, I expected d takes e5, which is, of course, horrible. Okay, I gotta take the bishop. It's piece is a piece.
Now, I've got two moves. The obvious rook takes e5 undermines his knight on d5. But maybe I can play a takes b5, threatening just to simply take on c6. Then on rook takes d6, I move my queen somewhere. I don't really trust it though. Rook takes e5 just gives me 3 pawns for the piece, and he's got his knight and rook hanging. You know, maybe he's giving me some chances now. Rook takes e5.
Okay, let's get this over with. Now my queen's in a bit of an awkward spot. The diagonal doesn't mean much now. I'd like to look at his f-pawn, it's weak, and support my knight. Queen f3, I'm bearing down on his f7 square, covers f6. What's he going to do about that? He can't take my rook. I get a terrible passed pawn again. Queen f3, this looks like it's puts the game on ice. Can maybe sack on that g6, the next move. Now this is easy. Queen f3.
Not really too much choice here. If I take on b5, then maybe bishop takes g6 is strong. I don't know, though. Well, I've got to do it anyway. I'll just pray that I can survive the attack. A takes b5.
Well, my piece is a little loose now. I better have something here. Of course, I figured on that move. Now, bishop takes g6. Doesn't that just kill him? What's he doing on that? Did he overlook that move? I'll bet he did. I'll bet he didn't take that into account. She's pretty cocky now. But that just turns the tables. I mean, it looks crushing. What's he gonna do? Bishop takes rook leads to mate. Pawn takes is horrible. It's got to take with a king. Put it out in cold ice. It's going to get mated. It looks like a forced win to me. Of course, knight b for nats. It's too passive. So I have to play aggressively here. He's got a lot of pawns. Count 1, 2, 4 pawns. Oh, yes, I sacked one earlier. He's got 4 pawns, huh? My rook's hanging. Now I gotta do something. Man, this is what I planned on, so. Bishop takes g6. Looks crushing.
Can I take on c6? Oh, God, no. Queen takes f7 just completely annihilates me. I've gotta take this bishop. And I can't take it with the pawn because of rook c7 check. Oh, I take with the king. What does he do? I don't know. I've got a lot of pawns. So I just play king takes bishop. Then I'm 3 pawns up. And also he's rook and knight. Very loose. Yeah, I think I can survive the attack here. King takes g6.
Well, this is about over. Rook f1. f6 is horrible. Just loses all at once. Among other things, to queen g3 check. Also, queen d3 check wins. So, rook f1, what is he going to do? He can't protect the f7 pawn with his queen. That leaves f6 weak. He can't take my rook, that's horrible. Queen takes pawn check and his rook f6 check followed. That's murder. I think I have a forced win. Yep, forced win. Right there. Rook f1 just seems to put the game on ice. Well, f5, how could that work? Nah. I just win his queen. Yeah, rook f1.
It's a bit too obvious, that was. It's looking grim now. How do I defend this f-pawn? Well, first idea is to take on c6, but queen takes f7 check and rook f6 check. Well, I must give up my queen. Oh, just don't believe that. I'm bound to be getting mated there. If I can't do that, then must move the pawn. F6. Well, maybe just queen D3 check. No, I must play F5 here. F5.
Well, this is really easy. Let me see. Queen G3 check. King back. Now, what is queen? Wait a second. This can't be real. Can he get his queen back? Oh, God. That's disgusting. What a lucky blankety blank. Play knight checks, too. That looks pretty good, too. Where's his king going? I'm going to have to take a pawn with check next move. Yeah, knight f4 check. This feels right intuitively. Gets out of that pin a little bit. Besides, he's got so many weak pawns. Every pawn is easy pickings. He might be three pawns up, but they're a laugh to me. Yeah, knight f4 check. God, it must be something better, though. Queen g3 check, doesn't it? I guess not. I should have something better than that. Justice. Where's justice? I guess he's left. Or she. Or whatever. Well, knight f4 check, though, it must be good.
Well, something we don't very often do on the master game. Position here where white obviously thinks he's winning, got all sorts of possibilities. What are his possibilities here?
Well, it's worth just looking at that little variation that he decided just not to play. Can we bring the knight back to d5? This was the line where justice deserted him. If Lowry had played queen g3 check, the black king has to go back to h7, and it seems for a moment that rook c7 check really ought to win for white, because if the king moves, the queen comes into g7 with mate. But black gives up his queen. This was the line they've both talked about giving up the queen. White takes back the queen with his knight. And now the move that he'd overlooked, the black rook comes to g8, attacking the white queen. And if the white queen moves out of the way, black rook and bishop both attacking this g2 pawn, black would play rook takes g2 check and would win back the white queen. And this is the line where fortune deserted him. It's crazy that after winning the black queen, black suddenly has this move that wins it back.
Well, that's not what's happened. Let's go back to the game just before that variation and see what does happen.
So after deciding this queen check didn't give him his, what he clearly believed was a well-deserved victory, he found another way to get at the black king. The knight has come back to f4, checking the black king.
That's a mild relief. I was more afraid of queen g3 check. Well, got to centralise my king now. Going to anywhere other than f6 allows the queen to come in with a check. Well, king f6, what does he do? His rook on c6 is still pinned. And if queen takes h5, no problem, I can just take his rook. Yeah, well, maybe he's overplayed his hand here. King f6, and I'll see what happens.
Why isn't there a forced or easy win? Why isn't life easy? Especially on the chessboard. I wanted to sew this thing up. I'd take on h5 check, and I guess he might bring his king to safety, and what am I going to do about that rook? It's amazing, that rook on e5 is a powerhouse. Rook on e5, get out of here. Protects everything. Okay, knight d5 check. I can take on h5, but he's going to move his king back into safety. I can take on d6. And then take on b7. I get some reasonable play, but it looks pretty risky. Well, what's he doing on knight d5 check? At least I can repeat moves. If he goes king e6... Let's play knight c7 check. Isn't that crushing? Yeah, of course. Can't bring his king into E6. It's a laugh. Oh, I can repeat moves and figure out a way to win next time. Knight D5 check.
That's interesting. A moment or two ago, I thought I was lost. Now he's almost offering a draw with knight d5 check. But I've got better than that now. If king e6, then on knight c7 check, just simply king d7, and I'm hitting his rook on c6. Seems to win, fair enough. All these pieces are hanging. King e6.
Okay, knight c7 check. Queen. Uh-oh. King d7. Oh, God. Rook fc1, rook c5, and I'm finished. What can I blame it on this time? Stupidity? The weather? Those excuses don't work. They'll laugh as usual. Oh boy, this is going to feel great. Well, I guess I can pull some excuse out of the hat. This is horrible now. I'm really feeling hot and sweaty. I'm so mad I could... Well, I have no choice. Make the best of it. How did I get in this mess? For sure I was winning. Now, all I can hope is for is a swindle. Maybe he'll give the game back to me. Yeah, knight f4 check. Oh, boy. Look at that smug look on his face. Oh, knight f4 check. Come on, Potzer, move.
Back to d7. Attack his rook. It's looking nice. He takes on d6. Take with the king. Not too many problems there. You know, pieces left. Well, I've not got too much to worry about here. And maybe I am winning this. King d7.
Well, I guess I'm the new apprentice for Bozo the Clown. Okay, rook fc1. Well, that's a joke. Rook c5. Same business. Rook takes d6 check. Well, that's... pretty feeble, but what else can I do? Nothing much. Knight g7, it's hopeless. Worked. I wish I get a pawn for it. Maybe his king will be a little exposed. I can trick him. Maybe I can get some play. Well, it's pretty bad. Come on, be logical. Maybe he'll blow it. You've swindled your share in your time, Larry. Okay, rook takes d6 check.
Not much choice. King takes d6.
Okay, let's eat that bishop. Queen takes b7.
Now, this is looking very nice. I've got a whole move to spare here, and he hasn't got any threats. Well, I like the look of that pawn on a3. Can't see any reason why I shouldn't take it. I'm winning this easily now. Rook takes a3.
Ho-hum. Let's see, knight g6. What does that do? Oh, not much. Should I shake hands, Larry? No, it's too early for that. Why give him the satisfaction? How about rook d1? Maybe he'll... be afraid of the giving up the exchange, although he'll only be 3 pawns ahead. Rook d1, well... forces him to make a good move. King c5 just forces it. But what else do I have? Can't play rook c1. Rook c3 just mops up. Maybe if I could win a pawn and the exchange, I'd be in the game. Maybe one of his passed pawns, especially that d-pawn, I hate it. Covers king too nicely. Okay, rook d1. I'll hope for the best.
I better defend that one. Rook a4. No, don't like that. Why not be aggressive? King c5. No problems. No problems there at all. The king is a strong piece. King c5.
Oh, darn. King c5, you had to see it. Played that pretty quick, too. That's discouraging. Okay. Rook c1 check. That doesn't do much, but under the circumstances, I can't let this king come in too far. Can't let it get completely safe. What about queen g7, though? Uh-oh, queen e7 just destroys that illusion. Threatens mate. Well, maybe I can give him a little bit of a problem with rook c1 check.
Rook c3, knight d3 check. Just move the king back. Then he exchanges everything and I'm 3 pawns up. And, yeah, even I can win 3 pawns up. Not a problem at all.
It was very extraordinary the way, with a single bound, as it were, he were free from a position which did look completely lost.
He's a phenomenal defensive player. I've seen him do this in several games against grandmasters, fighting back from positions when he's been under the most tremendous attack. And once the opponent has gone wrong, he's extraordinarily good at finding absolutely accurate king moves, especially.
I was going to say, it was very instructive, that last little bit we were seeing, how well he was using his king, getting it into the battle. Let's go back to the game now. It's short for black to play with a win in sight.
Almost any move wins here. But might as well queen my b pawn first. b3.
Oh, this is so exciting now. Gee whiz. Great game here, folks. I'll try g5. I'll laugh about it later, or cry.
Spot the winning move. b2.
Yeah, I'm sure he sees rook f2 check next, too. Should I resign now, or let him have that satisfaction? It is such a brilliant move. So close. Well, I'll let him play rook f2 check. Of course, he has a few other winning moves, but that finishes it nice and neatly.
Well, rook f2 checks the obvious move. Seems to win. The only problem is I get more money if I let him bribe me in this position. Never mind. Rook f2 check.
Let me see. Maybe we can go into the other room. Nah, it's too obvious. How could I draw a result from this position? Nah, they wouldn't believe that. I'd be thrown out of chess. Besides, Larry, you don't think those thoughts. Yes, he's a nice young kid. You don't want to corrupt him. Well, how about a knuckle sandwich? Nah, come on, Larry. Restrain yourself. Just resign peacefully. You've done it before. Then you go kick the walls in.
Nice game.
Thanks.
A polite, but I suspect not very honest, Larry Christiansen. And it leaves this position in the group. Earlier today, he must have had every expectation of winning this group. Now, the best he can hope for is a four-way tie after next week's game between Adoyan and Hecht. Until then, good night.